Welcome back to the Net Zero Energy and Transport Committee. This is agenda item 3, and I welcome everyone therefore to stage 2 proceedings on the Climate Change Bill, including our non-members of the committee who are here for this item. Deadline for completion of stage 2 is today, and the committee has permission to continue the meeting for as long as it takes to complete consideration. Just to remind people on the procedure, our main working documents for today are the bill, the marshalled list and the groupings. These are available on the Scottish Parliament's bill page for anyone observing. I'll call each amendment individually in the order of the marshalled list. The member who then lodged the amendment should either move it or say not moved when it's called. If that member doesn't move it, any other member present can do that. The grouping of the amendments set out in the amendments in the order they will be debated. There'll be one debate on each group of amendments. The member who lodged the first amendment in the group will be called to speak and move that amendment and to speak to any other amendments in the group. I'll then call other members with amendments in the group to speak to, but not to move their amendments, and to speak to all other amendments in the group if they so wish. I will then call other members who wish to speak in the debate, and if you wish to speak, try and catch my eye or indicate it to the clerk. I'll then call the Cabinet Secretary if she has not spoken already in the debate, and finally I'll call the member who moved the first amendment in the group to wind up and press or withdraw the first amendment in the group. If a member wishes to withdraw an amendment after it's been moved and debated, I will ask whether any member present objects. If there is an objection, I will have to put the question on the amendment. Later amendments in the group are not debated again when they are reached on the marshalled list. If they're moved, I'll put the question on them straight away. Only committee members may vote, and voting is by a show of hands. Now, I would ask committee members, please, to keep their hands raised long enough for the clerk to see their hands are raised and so they can record individually their votes. And I'll also put formally the question on each section and schedule of the bill as we come to it. I hope that brief run-through was helpful. I know most, in fact, all members of the committee have done this before, but it's actually often helpful for people who are watching online. Right, we will move to the marshalled list. First of all, I'm going to call Amendment 1 in the... Do you want me to read that? Yeah, okay, the clerks have suggested I read out the preamble. As an introduction, the presiding officer determined that a financial resolution was not required for the bill. Under Rule 912.6C, the presiding officer has determined that the costs associated with Amendment 19 would in themselves exceed the current threshold for a bill to require a financial resolution. Therefore, in terms of Stage 2 procedures, Amendment 19 may be moved and debated, but may not be agreed on in the absence of a final financial resolution. And we'll come to that when we get there. So I'm going to call Amendment 1 in the name of Graham Simpson, grouped with the amendments in shown in the groupings. Graham Simpson to move Amendment 1 and to speak to all amendments in the group. Graham.
Convener, thanks very much. First of all, I'd like to assure the committee that I'm going to keep my remarks as brief as possible. I know we are up against the clock, but that shouldn't preclude a proper debate, of course. But I will try and truncate what I was going to say. So Amendment 1, which I'm happy to move, basically says that a budget for a period must set out the proportion of the budget that is to be attributed to emissions from a number of sectors: transport, energy consumption, land use, aviation, shipping. Now, you know, the committee's taken evidence on this when you've produced your excellent report, so I don't need to rehearse the arguments for that. You know, and I, you know, it just That amendment is pretty straightforward. I don't really need to explain it any further. Amendment 3, I think there may be different views on that. Amendment 3 proposes full alignment with UK carbon budgets as set out in the Climate Change Act 2008, and there was debate around that. I remember there was very healthy contributions during the stage one debate. There will be different views in the committee. My view is, and indeed it was the view, I think, of the majority of respondents to the committee, that there should be alignment. So I can move on from that to Amendment 53. And this was a result, this came about as a result of some of the very good collaborative working that I've had with the Cabinet Secretary and her officials. That's been very refreshing. So Amendment 53, under the current provisions of the bill, ministers will be required to make a statement to Parliament setting out the extent to which each of the proposed carbon budgets take into account the target setting criteria and the latest advice from the Climate Change Committee. Following discussion at committee and during stage one debate regarding the further information that Parliament may require to conduct scrutiny on the budgets, this amendment adds to the information that must be included in that statement. Amendment 53 will require that ministers also share an indication of the policies and proposals that would likely be included in the next climate change plan should regulations be approved. And as I said, I've discussed it with the government. Having had that discussion, I understand that it will only be possible to publish this information in broadly indicative terms. Now, you've seen that phrase appears in the amendment. You might think, why is Graeme Simpson including such a woolly phrase in one of his amendments? That's not his style. And it's not. But however, I'm accepting it in the spirit of compromise, because I think... Yeah, absolutely.
I'm mindful of the time, but I just reflecting on that, broadly indicative, do you not think that we need to have more detail when we're setting the budgets about how government is actually going to meet those targets, meet those carbon reductions, and that there is a danger in what you put forward under 53, that it could actually be very loose. It could be as loose as, you know, a broad pathway that UK Climate Change Committee are putting forward, and it won't really enable this committee to really get into the guts of whether the targets that are being set, the budgets that are being set, are actually the right ones or not.
I think that's a useful intervention. I don't like woolly wording. Mr. Ruskell knows that. I don't like loose wording in legislation. So, you know, there is a risk that this could be seen as loose wording. However, I've accepted, in the spirit of compromise that I've approached this thus far, that the government will not at that stage, it won't be possible to set out in definitive terms the proposals and policies that will be in the next climate change plan, given that these need to be finalised once the carbon budgets are set. So I note that Ms. Martin made the point in the stage one debate that it will not be advisable to publish, in her words, a draft of the climate change plan. So this amendment represents a balance to ensure Parliament has the information it needs to conduct scrutiny and the Scottish Government's need to finalise the policies to meet carbon budgets once they've been set. So I would say if the committee is minded to support Amendment 53, then I would just invite it to take the view that Mark Ruskell's Amendments 6 and 7 are not required. Finally, in this group, Amendment 9 from me just seeks to align carbon budgets with the rest of the UK for the reasons that I've set out. And I will wait to hear from Ms. Lennon. Mr. Whittle isn't with us, but I understand Mr. Lumsden is speaking for him today, so I'll wait to hear their contributions. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Graeme. Monica, I'd ask you to speak to Amendment 28 and other amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. So I have four amendments in the group, 28, 29, 30 and 32. And I want to thank Stop Climate Chaos Scotland for their briefing today and for advice and support on these matters. Colleagues will be aware that Stop Climate Chaos Scotland previously called for the setting of budgets to be in accordance with the advice from the Climate Change Committee, unless there are exceptional circumstances. But as drafted, the bill only requires the Scottish ministers to have regard to the latest CCC advice in preparing the draft budget setting regulations. So the amendments I've put forward is to try and strengthen the provisions that are in the bill. I know at the moment the Scottish Government are not minded to support, but I hope that that will be reconsidered, because I think this have regard to duty should be strengthened to require the budgets proposed to be consistent with the CC advice, unless there are exceptional circumstances to justify a variance. As I said, SCCS strongly support amendments 28, 29, 30 and 32 in my name, and I'll take the intervention from Douglas Sampson.
I thank Monica Lennon for allowing the intervention. It's normally I'm in favour of strengthening the wording, but is there a danger here that the actual policy would then be sort of almost enforced on this Parliament by the Climate Change Committee, as opposed to actual Scottish Government actually putting policies in place to get to the carbon budgets? And that's the sort of danger of this.
No, I don't agree with that. I think the bill as drafted, with the term of have regard to, I think is weaker than many of us would like. And I think the evidence that we've heard at stage one reflects that. So the amendments, would strengthen, I think, the requirement to act in accordance with CC advice, but provides for a departure where there are exceptional circumstances. And I would say that that would be a better balance than what we have in the bill. So I was pausing to take another question there, but no. Okay.
Can I, Monica, can I intervene again?
Yes.
I'm just trying to understand what the exceptional circumstances might be. Mm-hmm. Any idea?
Well, when we had discussions at stage one, examples were given such as a pandemic, such as like COVID-19, if something like that was to happen again, or in a situation if there was an unusual event. I haven't attempted to be prescriptive, but I think the member knows the kind of situations that I'm talking about. I think the point is that, members will have to take a view if they think that have regard to is good enough, if that is robust enough. And in my view, it's pretty weak. So what I'm offering is to go a little bit stronger, but to still allow space if there are exceptional circumstances that government could set out its reasons for departing from CCC advice. In the interest of time, Convener, I'm not going to add to my remarks on my amendments. I'm not sure if Brian Whittle's amendment is going to be moved today. And I've listened to what Graeme Simpson has said. I would only say in terms of Amendment 1 and Graeme Simpson's name that I don't disagree with the intention behind it. But at the moment, I'm thinking that could be better placed in the climate change plan rather than in the budget. But I've listened to what Mr. Simpson has said.
OK, thank you. Can I just say to members, a couple of people have said in the interests of time, we must give this bill proper consideration. So I'm not trying to stop you debating it. So I'd just like it on record that if you want to make an intervention, it's a very valuable stage to committee meeting or consideration. So don't please feel restricted by time. If we get to the stage where we are going to be restricted by time, trust me, I'll let you know. But at the moment, we're not there. So now I'd also like to make a point that Brian Whittle has moved various amendments at this stage. And unfortunately, Brian Whittle, due to clashing of another committee that he's on, is unable to be at this meeting, which I know he regrets. And I believe he's asked Douglas Lumsden to speak to his amendments. So I now call Douglas Lumsden to speak to Amendment 46 and other amendments in the group. Douglas.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'm sure Mr. Whittle is full of regret for not being here today. Amendment 46 is really just to bring the wording more in line with the UK legislation. And it's putting issues that the carbon budgets must have regard to on the face of the bill, gives the government a clear direction and hopefully the ability to think cross-portfolio when it comes to the climate change plan. The need for the government to create climate change plans in a more holistic way is outlined by the CCC's evidence to committee. For example, if the government had given regard to social, economic and fiscal circumstance in creating their heat pump target, it may have been achievable. And that I'll just talk to 46, Convener.
Thank you, Douglas. Mark Russell, can I ask you to speak to Amendment 6 and any other amendments in the group? Mark?
Yep. Thanks so much, Convener. I'll speak to 7 and others in the group as well. So Amendment 6, in many ways, is similar to Amendment 1 that's being moved by Graham Simpson. It's about ensuring that there's real transparency in the budget, that if we're going to pass a carbon budget, that we know what the contribution will be from different sectors. I think that has not been clear when we've set targets, climate targets in the past, and we need to bring that transparency. The one thing I would say about my Amendment 6 is that it does pin it directly back to the 2009 Act. So I would gently ask Mr. Simpson if he would not move number 1 and allow me to move number 6, because it's just a tighter fit with what's in the existing legislation. In terms of Amendment 7, I think there was a huge sense of loss in Scotland and in the environment movement when the 2030 target, it was decided that it was no longer credible for us to meet that target of 75% reduction in emissions by 2030, because it really represented that hugely important need for action in this decade to tackle climate change and to get on top of this issue. The fact that that 75% target is now not credible, now no longer can be met by 2030 is really concerning. But it does beg the question, well, when are we going to get to 75%? You know, when are we going to get 3/4 of the way towards net zero? That's what people are asking. They need to know that, you know, if we are off track, then how much are we off track by? When will we meet that really important milestone? So I think we had discussion with the Cabinet Secretary at stage one around how the budgets can be kind of interpreted, if you like, to ensure that that target can still remain, it can still be transparent, people can still see, you know, by which date we're going to meet 75%. So what this motion does, it really ensures that the aspiration behind that, the 75% and the 90%, are still reflected and it's still transparent within the carbon budgets when they're passed. Just turning to some other amendments within this group, and obviously we've had a big discussion within this committee and in the chamber about whether these budgets should be aligned to the UK budgets or whether they should be, you know, standalone Scottish budgets. I mean, I do think on balance what's in the bill is the right approach, so I won't be supporting Amendment 9. I think, you know, there is almost like a ratcheting effect. If devolved administrations are bringing forward policy innovation, that's reflecting the climate change plans. That's set out pretty much at the beginning of a parliamentary session in Wales and in Scotland, and then that can then link into future development of climate change plans across the UK. So, you know, I'm convinced that's the right way to go forward, but appreciate there might be different views on that. Support what Monica Lennon's wanting to bring forward here with amendments 28 to 32. Clearly, UK Climate Change Committee come up with advice which sets out broad pathways. So acting within accordance to that, I think, is appropriate. I'm still not entirely sure what Amendment 46 is trying to achieve, so I'll listen to what the Cabinet... I'm not sure if Mr Lumsden does either, but we'll listen to what the Cabinet Secretary's views are on that. And then finally, in relation to 53, I mean, obviously we're going to have a debate later on about whether a draft plan should be presented at the time of the budget or slightly after the budget or several months after the budget. And I think this is very relevant to that. So I would say to Mr Simpson perhaps not to move 53, but I think given that he's already got support from the government, he may move it anyway. But I would say to him that, you know, we really need to tighten up the willingness around this. And I'm already thinking about, if that passes, about how we can make the presentation of information ahead of a budget actually meaningful. And I think we may well need to come back to that for stage three, because at the moment it's far too woolly, and Mr Simpson knows that. Right, that's me.
Okay, it didn't provoke a response. Just looking around the table to see if there any other members want to speak on this. Sarah Boyack.
Thanks very much, Convener. And I welcome the fact that you've told us not to edit our comments too succinctly. I think this is a key issue, because we do need to make sure that we scrutinise this legislation, because you've done it so fast. And I want to agree with Graeme Simpson, which is most unusual for me. But I think the committee report has been excellent and has helped us focus on amendments to support or not. I particularly wanted to speak to support Monica Lennon's amendments, because I think this is our chance to both scrutinise and to strengthen this legislation, and on occasion get scrutiny with more clarity from the Scottish Government. I think Monica's amendments strengthen the commitment to adhere to the Climate Change Committee's recommendations. I think that does actually encapsulate a lot of the amendments in this group, because it is about strengthening this process so that you've got a robust carbon budgeting process informed by expertise with as much transparency and accountability to the Scottish Parliament. So I think Graeme Simpson's principle of having a statement is really important, so that the whole Parliament is involved in this process. I think Monica's amendments require the Scottish Government to act in accordance with existent guidance, not just to be consistent with it, to make sure that any action taken is informed and impactful. I think that's really important going forward. So I want to engage in the discussion on this. And I do also, in addition to thanking the committee, I also want to thank Stop Climate Chaos Scotland, because the timescale has been so tight here. So to get their perspective on our different amendments, I think is really important. I think I would prefer Monica's amendments. I know there are alternatives in front of them. I think Brian Whittle's Amendment 46, for example, is too prescriptive for a scheme, because it's got a span, a variety of budgets, four budgets over 20 years. So it needs to be sufficiently flexible, but also accountable to Parliament. So just some few comments from me at this point, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you, Sarah. Just looking around the table before I go to the Minister. I just a couple of brief comments, if I could make them. First of all, I'd like to thank the Cabinet Secretary for engaging with committee members and within parties. I believe quite a lot of engagement has gone on, which, given the short timescale of the bill, I think has been helpful. Turning to my specific comments, there are amendments on Amendments 3 and 9. I've always held the view, as did the majority of witnesses that came to the committee, that alignment with the rest of the United Kingdom is in the interests of everyone. Now, the reason why I believe that, and I still believe it, despite the debate at stage one, where and the comments of Mark Ruskell this morning that says doesn't agree with it, I think if you have governments across the United Kingdom pulling together, working together, it gives business the confidence to pull and work together and gear up across the whole of the United Kingdom. And gearing up together means that when businesses produce technology, which we are definitely going to need if we are going to reach our targets, is that we are relying on technology that is proven rather than unproven, which may be the case if we try and go at a faster speed than the rest of the United Kingdom. So that is why I believe alignment's important, and I always have done. On the basis thereof, no other comments. I'm going to turn to the Cabinet Secretary for your comments. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. I just want to talk initially about Amendment 53. We've worked with Graeme Simpson on this amendment and obviously support it, but I am afraid I can't support the other amendments in this group, and I'll go through them in turn. Amendments 1, 6 and 53 I'll take together. Legal effect of Graeme Simpson's Amendment 1 is unclear to me. My strong view is that it would not be appropriate to mandate sector-level emissions targets, because it's important to keep the balance of effort of each sector under regular review. We know from experience that there will be a significant change in our exact decarbonisation pathway over the long term. We'll have new technologies coming online, the cost of measures in different sectors will change over time. We'll need to have the flexibility to be able to take account of possible job impacts and just transition impacts as well. And this is one reason why we all support this Bill's proposals to move to carbon budgets. So we need to retain that flexibility to decarbonise in the right way at the right time and adjust and adapt our approach in line with a just transition. So sector level legal targets are not something that have been advised by the CCC. And to the extent that Graeme Simpson's concerns about having more of an indication of the implications of a proposed budget at the time of considering proposals, I'm very pleased that we've been able to work together on Amendment 53. I've spoken with a number of members over the piece about the types of information on the various pathway options that would be available that we would be happy to give the committee and indeed in a statement ahead of deliberation of the secondary legislation. Amendment 53 requires an indicative statement of those implications to be set out in a statement accompanying the draft regulations. And I think that's the right way to provide Parliament with the information that it needs. I actually think it's going to vastly improve the scrutiny of the secondary legislation. I'm happy to have worked with Graeme on that. Rather than try to encode sectoral targets into law, as Amendment 1 seems to be trying to do. So on this basis, I would invite Graeme Simpson not to press Amendment 1. On the basis that I'm supporting Mr Simpson's Amendment 53, I don't support Mark Ruskell's Amendment 6, which covers much the same ground. If I can turn to Amendments 3 and 9 on the alignment in time of the carbon budgets, I would ask the committee not to support Graeme Simpson's Amendments 3 and 9. I've considered the options of aligning with UK carbon budgets, but I remain of the view that this approach in the bill as introduced is preferable for the reasons that I've stated in my response in stage one. I won't go over the ground there. I think Mark Ruskell's intervention has been very helpful. I mean, we have different elections happen at different times as well, and Mark makes a very good point about setting out your intentions at the start of a parliamentary session as well. And I have to say that I don't think that having a different carbon budget time envelope means that the governments across the UK don't work together. We've always had a Four Nations approach around this, and certainly even just 2 weeks ago had a Four Nations meeting on climate change with all my counterparts across all the four governments. Turning to Monica Lennon's amendments 28, 29, 30 and 32, the bill already requires that the Scottish Government must receive the CCC's advice before bringing forward regulations to set carbon budgets, and the bill as it's drafted already requires that where a government decides not to follow the CCC's advice to the letter, that you need to explain why. Scottish Government, Scottish Parliament receives informed, well-judged advice from experts across a number of policy areas, but that advice rightly informs, not dictates, what Parliament does and the judgment of Parliaments. These amendments, I believe, unfortunately, and I don't necessarily think that this is Monica Lennon's intention, but my interpretation and my official's interpretation of them, we believe it cuts to the quick of that essential role of Parliament in making that decision when the government's putting forward how they've accepted that advice. Yes.
Grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for setting out the position. I think the notion of dictating is a bit strong, and certainly that's not my intention, but you know, the advice from the CCC is very important, as broad as we've heard, but you know, it's based in science, it's expert advice. Does the Cabinet Secretary, you know,
not agree that it would be better to have a position of a presumption in favour of accepting that advice rather than leaving it, you know, what I think is quite weak in terms of have regard to. It's not about tying government's hands. That's why the amendments set out that there can be a departure, but reasons have to be given for that in exceptional circumstances.
So I've got two issues with that, is that the wording of in accordance effectively means that you must follow it. It does bind you. And the other is that the exceptional circumstances have not been defined. So we don't know what they are. And Douglas Lumsden's intervention, I think, was hinting at that. You're not able to define what exceptional circumstances are. But as I said, the bill as it's drafted already says, requires that where we don't follow CCC advice, we need to give an explanation as to why. Now, the CCC is free to design its approach to its advice, and we do take very close regard to it already. That's already set out. The advice is rightly focused on their assessment of a cost-effective and technical feasible emission reduction pathways. They have been clear that advice does not and should not take account of other factors, whether that's financial, the budget that's available to the government, policy or political. The type of government that's in, they need to have, obviously, an assessment of the CCC's advice, depending on what that government has been elected on. It's vital to bring in our country towards net zero in a way that reflects our commitment to just transition principles. And that's the response. What my point is, that's the responsibility of Parliament. Their advice is critical. It's a critical component of how we should set our carbon budgets, but it should not be the whole of how we set those carbon budgets. And I'm afraid that the wording of this amendment, that's where that leads to. I don't think it's appropriate for Parliament to be essentially legally bound to follow the CCC's advice, other than what's in the law recognises to be exceptional circumstances. I say they're not actually set out as to what they are. It cuts out the role of Parliament in weighing up the full range of considerations when setting carbon budgets and scrutinising plans. And also that information that Graeme Simpson wants the government to provide. Well, if we are already bound to just accept the Committee for Climate Change advice, what good does all that information do in terms of informing the Parliament's agreement on the setting of carbon budgets? Yes.
I can understand some of the reasons for maybe not accepting that, but I'm trying to think in terms of compromise, is there other wording that may be acceptable to strengthen the bill, but not tying the government's hands?
Yeah, and I think it will depend on how the vote goes today on this, because if Ms Lennon's amendments do pass with the words of in accordance, we would have to bring an amendment. We would be bringing an amendment to change the wording on that, because it is so strong and it does bind and it does miss out that particularly important scrutiny function and decision-making function of both the government and the Parliament that we report to on the setting of the carbon budgets. And obviously that's something that I think that I would hope that every member of this committee would take into account. In my view, we must preserve the freedom of Parliament to set carbon budgets at the levels that they consider to be the best for Scotland. Parliament must take account of the advice of the CCC, but we must not allow our judgment to be bound by it. The committee has a critical role in deciding the outcome of secondary legislation on carbon budgets. I'll leave it there. I think I've made my point. I would not be at all comfortable with the wording of in accordance with. So I can't support those amendments. Amendment 46, Brian Whittle's amendment, I don't have much to say in it because I think it duplicates some of the existing target setting criteria. It modifies others. I think it's confusing. We already do quite a lot of what I think Mr. Whittle is asking us to do. He's not here to obviously take questions on these amendments, but I don't really understand what it's trying to achieve, and I hope the committee will reject the amendment. Amendment 7, I can't support Mark Ruskell's Amendment 7, which would require the Scottish Government to highlight whether a 70% or a 90% emissions reduction from the baseline would be achieved during the period of a budget when bringing forward draft regulations to set the budget. It kind of defeats the purpose of this bill and the decision that we have made to bring forward a carbon moving from annual and interim targets to a carbon budget system like our other counterparts across the UK. Amendment 7 risks creating confusion around what are the real targets, and so would not provide the clarity needed for a journey to net zero. It's also technically deficient in its drafting because it's not clear in respect of what period the reductions it describes are to be looked for. Baseline figures are, annual, but budget periods are not. And for these reasons, I urge the committee not to support Amendment 7. And that's me. I've come to the end of my remarks, but it's up to
you. I think the Minister came to the end, so I'm going to move to Graham Simpson to wind up, and press or withdraw your amendment.
Yeah, thanks very much. Very brief, actually. I think it's been a useful discussion. I have to agree with those who've commented on Brian Whittle's Amendment 46. I also am a little bit confused by it, perhaps Mr. Lumsden might be minded not to press that. Mr. Whittle can perhaps come back at stage three. It is disappointing. I have to say it is disappointing the Cabinet Secretary in this group only appears to be supporting the amendment, which is in my name, granted, but that she had a hand in. So nothing else. And I think that, to me, that's disappointing. I think she could have perhaps worked, but perhaps she has, worked with other members. In relation to my Amendment 1, which is similar to Mark Ruskell's Amendment 6, which I've already invited members to reject, but I would ask members to accept Amendment 1. I'll leave it there.
Thank you very much, and I'm sure Mr. Whittle will take into comments his amendment in due course. The question we're at the moment, though, is that Amendment 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed? No. We're not agreed, therefore there will be a division. Those in favour of Amendment 1, please raise their hands. Those against Amendment 1, please raise their hands. And abstentions. There are two votes for, four against, and one abstention. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. I therefore call Amendment 2 in the name of Maurice Golden, group with Amendment 10. Maurice Golden to move Amendment 2 and speak to the amendments in the group.
Thank you, Convener. So Amendments 2 and 10 essentially put on the face of the bill that they should not permit any carry-forward mechanism. There's no explicit provision in the bill to permit this, and indeed the Scottish Government has previously indicated that it has no intention of seeking to undertake any carry-forwards. However, the bill does not explicitly prohibit these, and thus it could be possible for a future government to change that practice and in fact utilise carry forwards. So therefore my amendments codify existing practices from the Scottish Government, and I look forward to support on that basis from the committee.
Thank you very much. Looking around to see if any other members want to contribute. Doesn't appear so, Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you. I do understand what Maurice Golden is trying to achieve with these amendments, but I want to set out why they're unnecessary and it could confuse the legislation. Amendment 2 is about preventing an unused carbon budget for one period being carried over to the next. The bill already doesn't allow that. Budgets will be set by regulations on the basis of expert advice following that close parliamentary scrutiny. It will only be possible to increase them by making new regulations, also on the basis of expert advice following that close parliamentary scrutiny. And there is very deliberately no equivalent to Section 17 in the UK Climate Change Act, which allows the UK Government to choose to carry over part of the budget. We've done that on purpose for the reasons that, you know, I agree with Maurice Golden on. I therefore don't think that Amendment 2 would achieve anything except perhaps creating an avenue potentially for litigation over whether expert advice or the Parliament's decision to increase a budget was somehow tainted by the consideration of a previous budget would be met. And Amendment 10 similarly trying to address an issue that does not exist in Scottish climate change legislation. The concern seems to be that regulations under Section 13 of the 2009 Act could somehow allow carbon credits, for example, units purchased on that international carbon exchange, to be used as a, to reduce the net Scottish emissions account in more than one period. But Sections 13 and 13A are very clear that regulations can only provide for units to be credited in respect of a specific period. So Amendment 10 is therefore also unnecessary. It's not at all clear what periods it means. It refers to the period or the next period. So I would urge, with respect, Maurice Gold not to press either amendment and for the committee to not support if he does.
Secretary, Maurice Gold to wind up and press withdraw amendment 2.
Thank you for that. I think that any technical changes can be incorporated into stage 3, and on that basis I'd like to press amendment 2.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 2 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed, therefore there will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hand. Those against, please raise their hands. And there are no abstentions. There are 2 votes for, 5 votes against. Therefore, the amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 3 in the name of Graham Simpson, already debated with Amendment 1. Graham Simpson to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 3 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. Therefore, there will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 2 votes for, there are 5 votes against, therefore the amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 28 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 1. Monica Lennon to move or not move? The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We're not agreed, therefore there'll be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 4 votes for, there are 3 votes against, therefore the amendment is agreed. I call Amendment 29 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 1. Monica Lennon to move or not move? The question is, Amendment 29 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 4 votes for, there are 3 votes against, therefore the amendment is agreed. Yep, I've been told to slow it down, so I shall do that. I call Amendment 30 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 1. Monica Lennon to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 30 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 4 votes for, there are 3 votes against, therefore the amendment is agreed. I call Amendment 46 in the name of Brian Whittle, already debated with Amendment 1. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move?
Not moved.
Not moved. Right, I now call Amendment 52 in the name of Monica Lennon, grouped with amendments as shown in the groupings. Monica Lennon to move Amendment 52 and speak to all amendments in the group. Monica.
Thank you, Convener. I move Amendment 52 and I'll speak to the other amendments in my name, which are 54 and 37. And just to begin by putting on record my thanks to the Acting Cabinet Secretary and her officials for their time and willingness, I think it's fair to say, to work with all members who have an interest in the bill. And I'm pleased to see that we have worked together on a couple of the amendments I'm about to speak to. So as briefly as I can, perhaps not about the clock, but the interest of my voice today, I've got some throat lozenges at the ready. So just to explain 52, this amendment
will change the timing for the ministerial statement to accompany the laying in Parliament of draft regulation setting carbon budget levels. Ministers must publish a statement to set out how the regulations take account of the target setting criteria established in the 2009 Act and the most up-to-date advice received from the Climate Change Committee. Amendment 52 will ensure that ministers must publish a statement on the same day as the regulations are laid, rather than as soon as reasonably practicable afterwards. As I've said, I've worked with the government to develop this amendment, and I hope that, members will support the aims and vote for the amendment tonight. And just to add, we've had a briefing from Stop Climate Chaos Scotland in support of Amendment 52, and I know in the briefing SCCS states that it seems inexplicable that the statement could be laid later than the regulation, possibly as little as a day before or even after Parliament is asked to agree the regulations that the statement supports and explains. I think, again, that speaks in favour of Amendment 52. Amendment 54, again, I've worked with the Scottish Government on this. This amendment ensures that draft regulations to set carbon budgets will be subject to pre-laying scrutiny by invoking the procedure described in Section 97 of the 2009 Act. The amendment provides an exemption from this pre-laying procedure for the first such draft regulations. And this is in recognition both of the need for Parliament to have sufficient time for scrutiny of these important regulations and of the need for urgency at this current juncture, since I think we are all agreed upon the need for a new climate change plan to be in place as soon as possible. So again, I hope colleagues can support Amendment 54. Amendment 37, again, is another one that deals with timescales. This amendment would require that carbon budget regulations be brought forward within 90 days of royal assent. And I think hopefully this is quite self-explanatory, but I think it's important to provide some clarity on that. And I'm not going to speak to the other amendments in the group, but I'm happy to listen to colleagues. But I would note that I think Amendment 5 in the name of Mark Ruskell appears to be a minor amendment, but it provides for further detail on the statement laid by ministers regarding carbon budgets. And again, remind us to support that, but happy to listen.
Thank you very much, Monica. I now call on Mark Ruskell to speak to Amendment 5 and any other amendments in the group. Mark.
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. I'll speak to 5 and 59 and just offer some comments on the amendments that have already been discussed. So, first, I'd like to thank Stop Climate Chaos Scotland for the detailed engagement with this bill and discussion around how it can be improved. I think reflecting on the evidence that we took at stage one, setting a carbon budget is a very important step, and the removal of targets in this bill, the removal of interim targets and the move over to that process is a very significant step this Parliament is taking. I appreciate the timescale issues around the setting of the first carbon budget, but I do feel that a super affirmative instrument is the best way forward for committees to scrutinise budgets, to take evidence from those who are going to be delivering carbon reductions, to get the granularity of the discussion around the contributions of sectors, which we've already discussed this morning, and to come to a judgment about whether the carbon budget is adequate or not. Now, as I said, I recognise the situation that we're in with this first carbon budget that will come forward, the need to expedite that quickly. So, you know, 5 and 59 do not apply to that first budget. But I think going forward, of course, we need to have adequate scrutiny. And I think the kind of situation we could be in where this is passed through an affirmative instrument and in theory, a committee could just discuss it in the morning, I think would be ridiculous. So I think the evidence points the need for a more thorough super affirmative process, and that's what 5 and 59 puts forward, and I'd like to put that to committee for a decision here today. In terms of 52, I mean, I think, yeah, it makes sense that the government would publish how those target setting criteria being taken into account. So, you know, welcome what Monica Lennon is putting forward there. I'm interested to hear from the Cabinet Secretary on both 37 and 45, which establishes a timescale for introduction of that first carbon budget. Is it 90 days? Is it 3 months after the carbon CCC's advice? You know, I guess my impression is that the Scottish Government already has a lot of advice. It already has advice from the CCC. What will come in the spring next year will be more about the second and third carbon budgets. But I'm interested in her thoughts on that and what she considers practicable right now, given the advice that they've already got and how quickly they can bring forward that first carbon budget.
Thank you very much, Mark. I now call on Graham Simpson to speak to Amendment 45 and any other amendments in the group. Graham.
Yeah, thanks very much. Amendment 45 requires the Scottish ministers to lay draft regulations to set carbon budgets within 3 months of receiving advice on Scottish carbon budget levels from the CCC. This amendment speaks to a recommendation from this committee's Stage 1 report, in which the committee highlighted the need to specify a maximum amount of time which could elapse between receipt of the advice from the relevant body and the laying of draft regulations to set the first carbon budgets. So this is another one where I've worked with the government. I originally had said 2 months, but we settled on 3 months. I don't think that four-week difference is worth quibbling about. I'm happy with this amendment. I'm happy with the compromise, and ask the committee to support it. Just to mention the two amendments here from Mark Ruskell, 5 and 59, I'm fully supportive of any extra scrutiny that a super affirmative procedure would provide. I think it's really important. So I would urge the committee to support 5 and 59. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Looking to see if any other member wants to contribute. Therefore, I'm going to move to the Cabinet Secretary. Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Convener. So I appreciate the balanced need for urgency, but also for sufficient parliamentary scrutiny. It's why it's pleased to be able to work with Monica Lennon and Graham Simpson on Amendments 52, 54 and 45 in the group. But I would urge the committee not to support Amendments 5, 59 and 37. Amendment 52 from Monica Lennon responds directly to one of the recommendations from the Stage 1 report to publish the statement accompanying the draft carbon budget regulations on the day those regulations are laid before Parliament. Amendments 5 and 59 from Mark Ruskell and Amendment 54 from Monica Lennon concern the parliamentary scrutiny of regulations setting carbon budgets after the first set of regulations. Amendment 54 adopts an extended scrutiny procedure already found in the 2009 Act, and it's more of a balanced proportionate approach than Mark Ruskell's amendments. So I would urge members to support 54 in preference to Amendments 5 and 59. I mean, on one hand, I do understand, or I would have understood, the need for extended parliamentary scrutiny, but we have just agreed to act in accordance with the Committee for Climate Change's advice, regardless of that scrutiny. So I think that's a little bit confusing now. Amendments 37 and 45, Graeme Simpson's Amendment 37, Monica Lennon's Amendment 45 set a timescale for producing the first draft regulations to set carbon budgets. I can't support Monica Lennon's because it starts the period from royal assent, which fails to take into account the fact that legally the government cannot go ahead with budget proposals without having CCC advice. So Amendment 45 recognises this by setting a 3-month deadline for regulations that starts with the receipt of CCC advice, which means that it's competent and definitive. So I therefore urge the committee to support Amendment 45 and reject Amendment 37.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Monica Lennon, to wind up, and press or withdraw Amendment 52. Monica.
Thank you, Convener. So I won't be withdrawing on 52, but I've listened to what the Cabinet Secretary has said, and I won't press on Amendment 37, and I will support Graeme Simpson's Amendment 45. Again, I'm grateful to the Cabinet Secretary for working with me on Amendments 52 and 54. I'm grateful to Mark Ruskell for bringing forward Amendments 5 and 59 and support, again, what he was trying to do. But, you know, I do agree with the Cabinet Secretary, but that 5 and 59 are alternatives to the amendments in my name. So I would ask the committee to support my amendments, and I will not be pressing 37.
Thank you very much, Monica. The question, therefore, is that Amendment 52 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. I therefore will call Amendment 32 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 1. Monica Lennon, to move or not move? The question is that Amendment 32 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are four for and there are three against. Therefore, Amendment 32 is agreed. I call Amendment 5 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 52. Mark Ruskell, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question, therefore, is that Amendment 5 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. Those who abstentions, please raise their hands. Right, we're in that situation where I, as the convener, has the casting vote. Now, in the past 8 years, when I've been a convener, I've always made it abundantly clear that I will cast my vote in the way that I originally voted. That's the way I will use my vote. So, therefore, we are 4 in agreement, 3 against. How does that work? How do I announce that? I'm looking at the clerk.
It goes through in your casting vote.
Okay, so it goes through on my casting vote. It's as simple as that. Amendment 5 is agreed. I therefore call Amendment 6 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 1. Mark Ruskell, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 6 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There is one vote for, there are 6 votes against, therefore the amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 7 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 1. Mark Ruskell, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Therefore, call Amendment 53 in the name of Graeme Simpson, already debated with Amendment 1. Graeme Simpson, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 53 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 59 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 52. Mark Ruskell, to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 59 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. There are 3 votes for, there are 4 votes against, therefore the amendment is not agreed. I call Amendment 9 in the name of Graeme Simpson, already debated with Amendment 1. Graeme Simpson, to move or not move?
Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 54 in the name of Monica Lennon, already debated with Amendment 52. Monica Lennon, to move or not move?
Move.
The question is that Amendment 54 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. Therefore, there will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. Those who wish to abstain, please raise their hands. There are 6 votes for, there are no votes against, and there is 1 abstention. Therefore, the amendment is agreed. The question is that Section 1 be agreed. Are we all agreed? Yes, we are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 10 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 2. Maurice Golden, to move or not move?
Not moved.
Right. I now call Amendment 60 in the name of Patrick Harvey, grouped with Amendments 61 and 63. Patrick Harvey, please can you move Amendment 60 and speak to amendments in the group? Patrick.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning. As a non-member, I'll speak to my own amendment and I'll leave members of the committee to comment on the other amendments in the group. Amendment 60 is not grouped with Amendment 17, which will come up later, but they do touch on a similar issue around, and I think in some ways they should be seen together, around how we examine the carbon impact or the climate impact of major capital projects. When we come to Amendment 17, that will be in relation to the climate change plan. Amendment 60 raises the same issue in relation to the report which the government will publish on carbon budgets. Now, obviously, there will be some major capital projects, pieces of infrastructure that the government is proposing which are contentious. There'll be others that are uncontentious. And that'll be true regardless of whether they're high carbon or low carbon pieces of infrastructure. But that judgment has to be made in the basis of a full, proper assessment of the likely impact of capital projects. Even some projects which the government continues to support, it has agreed that there need to be carbon assessments. The government's policy on the A96, for example, it has committed to a carbon assessment, a climate compatibility assessment, of that proposition. And I think regardless of whether anybody supports or opposes particular projects, we should reach those decisions and those judgments on the basis of a proper assessment. I think it's unreasonable that we are still in the position, I think, of not having clear legislative basis for that assessment being required. And I suggest as well that even the government recognises that the status quo isn't ideal, and I understand that they are working on how they would regard a net zero test applying to decisions like this. So this is, well, either one or both of these amendments seek to find a way for the Parliament as a whole to be able to reach a view on infrastructure and capital projects on the basis of a full assessment of the impact that they would have either on carbon budgets or on the ability to deliver a climate change plan. On that basis, I would move Amendment 60. I look forward to hearing the government's response and to know either whether they would be open to the amendments that I propose or have an alternative approach to how this issue could be addressed in the legislation before we get to stage 3.
Thank you, Patrick. I'm now going to call Douglas Lumsden to speak to Amendment 61 and other amendments in the group. Douglas.
Thanks, Convener. 61 and 63 is really just putting timescales in place for when the reports come, 30 days that they have to be have to come to a committee to be considered, and then debated in Parliament within 60 days. It also has timescales in there that the report must come before 140 days before the end of Parliament, and that is just to make sure that Parliament has the necessary time to scrutinise it before Parliament is dissolved. 61 and 63 both do these functions.
Thank you very much. Just looking around, no other member wishes to speak. Cabinet Secretary, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. The Scottish Government can't support the amendments in this group. Amendment 60, regarding Patrick Harvey's Amendment 60, I'm mindful of the need to avoid too many requirements for assessment following on major capital projects, especially when it provides limited value output. But Patrick Harvey's other amendment, which we haven't isn't in this group, it's in Group 9, Amendment 17, also deals with emissions in relation to major capital projects. And I'll come to in that group, seems to be the better place for such a requirement, and happy to work with him on that. I'd ask him not to press Amendment 60, but work with me ahead of Stage 3 on refining Amendment 17. So that we can support that. I can't support Amendments 61 and 63, mainly because I don't think that it's appropriate to have the legal system policing how Parliament does its scrutiny. The amendments that Douglas Lumsden's putting forward, and I don't actually think this is Douglas's intention, it would create a duty for Parliament to mandate that Parliament's required to do in relation to reports from the government under sections 33, 34A and 35B. And that would mean that parliamentary procedure might be subject to review by the courts if Parliament, for any reason, was unable to fulfil the duties proposed by those amendments. So I would warn against supporting that amendment for that reason. Because both those amendments would require a committee of a Parliament to report in relation to government reports within a fixed timescale, and if they're not complied with, then they'd be breaking the law. When the government lays a report in front of Parliament, shared with relevant committees, available to all MSPs, it should be for the lead committee at the same time to decide when and for how long it wants to scrutinise and respond to such report. Not for that to be in law. I'm also concerned that Amendment 61 would be impossible for ministers to comply with. It would impose a deadline of over 4 months prior to the end of the parliamentary session, whereas the greenhouse gas statistics are published in June each year. For this amendment to be workable, the timing of the reports under, as I said, under 33, 34A would also need to be amended. And Amendment 63 has obviously got similar timescale challenges. So I would urge the committee to reject Amendments 61 and 63 for those reasons.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Patrick Harvey, can I ask you to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 60, Patrick?
Thank you, Convener. Obviously, I'll comment on the specific issues that were raised in relation to 17 when we reach that group, but they are connected. And when framing these, I think I was seeking to explore the relevance either to the report on the carbon budgets or to the climate change plan. Given the Cabinet Secretary's comments, I'm happy to explore whether there are an alternative that can gain agreement for Stage 3. Obviously, I'd hope that discussion will be fruitful. If not, then I'll reserve the option to return at Stage 3 with this amendment. But for the time being, I'll ask to withdraw it.
Thank you. The member wishes to withdraw the amendment. Does any member wish to object to the amendment being withdrawn? No one does. In that case, the amendment is withdrawn. I therefore call Amendment 38 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, group with amendments as shown in the groupings. Douglas Lumsden to move Amendment 38 and speak to all the amendments in the group. Douglas.
Thank you, Convener. I'll move 38 just basically, but I won't be pressing 38, 39 and 40, but I'll move it so we can have debate within this group, because I will actually be supporting Amendment number 48, because it covers what I was able to do with 38, 39. And 40. I guess one thing about 40, it's still lacking in timescales and a statement to Parliament. So if 48 passes today, I'll try and come back with something at Stage 3 on this to try and improve Maurice Golden's amendment further. In terms of the other amendments, 13, we'll be supporting this because once it again adds a timescale, so yeah, more than happy to support. 23 from Graham with a monitoring plan seems sensible, as most things do from Graham Simpson, and identifies risks, so is the right way forward. And 57 as well, happy to support Monica Lennon's one. Once again, it's adding timescales and a deadline to the whole process, which I feel improves the bill.
Thank you very much, Douglas. Mark Ruskell, can I ask you to speak to Amendment 13 and other amendments in the group? Mark?
Yeah, thanks very much. Happy to do so. And this amendment is about improving the Section 36 process, the catch-up reports. You know, the committee took evidence on, you know, just how inadequate the last two catch-up reports were. They were late. They were very thin on detail. They often just reflected existing policy and the existing ambition of the Scottish Government. And, you know, we took evidence from Environmental Standards Scotland about the poor quality of those Section 36 reports. So I think it's important to put a framework into this bill that ensures that where we miss a target, where there's a need for a catch-up report, that what comes back is meaningful, that it comes back within 6 months, that it isn't just a restatement of existing policies that are required under Section 35 as part of the climate change plan, but it actually course corrects. It actually shows how the government will get back on track with targets. So I would urge members to consider voting for 13, because it is a stronger approach. I think if there, you know, is a consensus between the government and Mr. Golden on 48, you know, I would raise concerns about that. I would raise concerns about whether the provision that Mr. Golden brings forward could just lead to a restatement of existing policies, and actually whether these catch-up reports are actually going to be meaningful on the back of what he's proposing under 48. I think in terms of Monica Lennon's, you know, 57, again, you know, that's emphasising the issue about 6 months, but I think that's better wrapped up into what I'm proposing under 13. And in terms of Douglas Lumsden's, I think 38, 39 and 40, it's, you know, appropriate that annual reports do trigger some form of corrective action. Happy to support that. Happy to support Graham Simpson's amendment under 23, which is really about looking ahead to circumstance where a target may be missed and kind of forecasting. So that seems sensible as well. But I would say to members that, you know, we can't see the kind of quality of catch-up reports, wherever they're originated from in legislation, coming back to this Parliament again in the way that they did. There needs to be more of a framework around this. And if 48 passes, then I will be looking at stage three to put more conditions onto this. So what we get back is actually meaningful and actually enables Parliament to look at a proper plan for course correction in the event of a missed target.
Thank you very much, Mark. I'm going to call Graham Simpson now to speak to Amendment 23 and the other amendments in the group. Graham.
Yeah, thanks very much, convener. I was actually minded not to press this, but having heard comments so far, I think I'm going to when we get to it. The reason I wasn't going to press it is I thought there was some overlap with Mr. Golden's Amendment 48, which would require ministers to take additional measures if they're off track to meeting a carbon budget. Similarly, with Douglas Lumsden's Amendments 38 to 40. But having heard Mr. Ruskell speak, I think my Amendment 23, which is about monitoring and evaluation, I think I would be minded to press that at this point, and if there is an issue with it, it can be dealt with at stage three. Thank you.
Okay, thank you. I've called you already. We don't need to hear again, so I'm going to move to Maurice Golden to speak to Amendment 48 and any other amendments in the group. Maurice.
Thank you. My amendment will require ministers to assess when preparing that report whether it's likely, more likely than not, that the carbon budget will be met for the given period. If the target is more likely than not to be met, then this amendment requires ministers to explain why that is the case and what they intend to do to ensure the target is met. The amendment will provide another layer of reporting and monitoring on the annual progress towards carbon budget targets through a strengthening of the provision in Section 35B of the 2009 Act. And delighted. Yes.
Thank Maurice Corbyn taking intervention. How is that different to what we have at the moment?
Well, I think it's a step in the right direction, and I'm pleased to have worked with the Scottish Government on strengthening reporting and monitoring, and I would hope the committee believes that that is something that should be done, and I would ask the committee to support the amendment. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you, Maurice. I now call Monica Lennon to speak to Amendment 57 and any other amendments in the group. Monica.
Thank you, Convener. I will speak to Amendment 57 in my name, and again, pleased to say that I've worked with the Scottish Government on this amendment. It will require the Scottish Government to lay a Section 36 report within 6 months of a target being reported as missed. This amendment will replace the current requirement for such a report to be laid as soon as reasonably practical after the report which indicated that the target had been missed. Ministers will continue to be required to set out proposals and policies to compensate in future years for excess emissions resulting from any missed target. I heard what Mark Ruskell said in relation to his Amendment 13, and you know, I would gently suggest to members, given that I have worked closely with the Government on this, following our Stage 1 evidence, that they would support Amendment 57 in my name as the alternative. I don't intend to speak to all the other amendments. I was looking for that clarification from Douglas Lumsden in relation to his amendments 39 and 40, because I was you know, thinking that they would be alternates to each other. And in relation to Graeme Simpson's Amendment 23, I think I understand the intent behind this, but the concern I have, it would be perhaps too impractical or place too much demand on the Scottish Government when we have Amendment 48 providing a mechanism for ministers to monitor whether government is on track to meet a carbon budget and take remedial action when they're off track. But I have no further comments to add, Convener.
Thank you very much. Looking around the room. Oh, Sarah Bye.
Thanks very much, Convener. I think these are important amendments in this group, and I particularly want to support the amendment from Monica, which she just outlined. I think it's about the principles of scrutiny and transparency, and I think we have to learn the lessons on how we got here. And there is an issue about the government monitoring and identifying where failure has happened in the, you know, 9 of the last few targets. So I think this is important for future going forward to avoid not scrutinising where failure is coming down the track, so that we get action, we strengthen the responses, and you can get a dynamic response to the future challenges. So I think the amendments that are in here, 38 and 39, 48 and 57, are really important to strengthen this piece of legislation. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much, Sarah. Just looking around to see if there's any other members. No. Cabinet Secretary, we're over to you.
Thank you, Convener. Amendments 38, 39 and 40 from Douglas Lumsden and Amendment 48 in the name of Maurice Golden are all concerned with requiring the Scottish Government to report to Parliament when it's become clear that emissions are not on track for staying within a carbon budget. And I agree that there should be a specific trigger for ministers to report to Parliament should it become clear that the Government's off track. However, I have said previously, I don't think this trigger should be linked to annual emissions reporting, for a very good reason, is that annual emissions reporting would have a 2-year time lag. And I wish I'd actually used the words that Sarah Boyack just used, a dynamic response would be better with having actually the real-time data. So therefore, this is why I've worked with members on these amendments to ensure there's actually a better alternative to a Section 36 report, Section 35B of the 2009 Act. It would be far more effective for the requirement to be linked to annual progress plans under Section 35B, because linking that requirement to these reports makes most sense. They contain the most up-to-date information on progress in decarbonisation and policy actions, not data from 2 years previous. So that's what the amendment of number 48 in the name of Maurice Golden does. I was glad to work with him on that amendment and explain the rationale for that. So I'd urge members to support it and reject amendments 38, 39 and 40. I think that amendment 48 does what they are requiring, but in it better and dynamic, I think, is the word that I'll continue to use in relation to that. With regards to Amendment 13, I accept that a more specific timeframe for the laying of a section in the 36 report in Parliament would be reasonable, but I have concerns with the other elements of the amendments, a certain amount of ambiguity relating to the requirements on additional policies and proposals to be included in the report. The existing position of the Scottish Government is that the policies and proposals introduced through the section of the 36 report are additional to those in the climate change plan, whether they are new or strengthened or enhanced policies. So I can't support this amendment because there is ambiguity then put in to this requirement. I have said I'm content with more specific timescale being set for Section 36 reports, so I'm pleased that I've been able to work with Monica Lennon on Amendment 57, which sets that six-month deadline for laying a Section 36 report from the date when the corresponding Section 33 report is laid. So I therefore urge Mark Ruskell not to press Amendment 13 and instead support Amendment 57. Amendment 23 from Graeme Simpson. Well, first of all, what I want to say in response to Graeme Simpson there is that Graeme Simpson's original view on Amendment 48 was actually right. You know, it is a better amendment. It's actually providing better action compared to the other alternatives. There is already a monitoring framework for climate change plans, and they include monitoring risks to delivery. So further, with the other provisions of this bill, there would be three annual reports on Scotland's decarbonisation progress. There would be annual reports on greenhouse gas emissions, annual climate change plan monitoring reports, which include an assessment of policy implementation, and annual requests to the CCC for a Scottish progress report. So that's three monitoring and evaluation points and reports associated with that. And as we discussed, Maurice Golden's Amendment 48 requires that ministers assess that the progress is off track. When preparing a Section 35B report, they must explain why it's the case and what they intend to do. Yeah, well, in a second. They must explain why it's the case and what they intend to do to ensure that the target is met. So I actually think that what has been proposed with 48 covers the basis here.
Thank the Cabinet Secretary for taking the intervention. Just to assist me as I deliberate my own Amendment 23, I would agree that Maurice Golden's Amendment 48 is very, very good. Does the Cabinet Secretary think that my Amendment 23 introduces an element of duplication?
Yes. Yes. I mean, that was my final point, is that if this were to pass, then it would mean effectively that we'd have a duplication of the information that's already in those three reports that I had mentioned.
Thank you.
Yes, so I've pretty much come to the end of my... I'd urge Graeme Simpson not to press Amendment 23 and instead support Amendment 48. Yes.
Sorry. Apologies to interrupt.
You got in the last second
to get in
there.
The last, and,
it's like a panel game.
Just wondering if the Cabinet Secretary could reflect a bit on the evidence that we had for Environment Standards Scotland. There is a deep concern about the quality and the depth of information that was in those catch-up reports that were on the back of Section 36. And I think, you know, beyond what Mr. Golden's put forward as a new framework going forward, what is the government doing to really reflect on that and improve that going forward? Because I think many people were quite shocked by how thin those reports were and how they didn't really bring anything new in terms of action to the table.
Well, the proposal that we've worked with Maurice Golden on is actually already strengthening the action that the government have to take to actually introduce catch-up policy interventions if those targets look like they're being missed. But again, has that robust in-time data, not 2 years old data to react to. So I actually think it's actually strengthening that. But actually, the criticism that Mark Ruskell has put forward and others have put forward about the material that's in those reports is something that I certainly will reflect on and obviously speak to my colleagues about how we can have more comprehensive reports going forward. But I think the fact that we're actually the 35B type report, which has that critical in-time data rather than the out-of-date data of 2 years, hence that Section 36 report would actually mean that it's a more useful report than maybe some of their proposals.
I wasn't sure if that was another hesitation, Cabinet Secretary, whether you finished that bit.
I'm finished.
Thank you. Douglas Lumsden, could I ask you to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 38? Douglas.
Nothing further to say. And I will not be pressing 38.
Okay, the member doesn't wish, seeks to withdraw Amendment 38. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? Okay. I therefore call Amendment 39 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, already debated with Amendment 38. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move?
Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 40 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, already debated with Amendment 38. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move?
Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 61 in the name of Douglas Lumsden, already debated with Amendment 60. Douglas Lumsden to move or not move?
Moved.
The question is that Amendment 61 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We are not agreed. There will be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. And those who wish to abstain, please raise their hands. There are three votes for, there are three votes against, there is one abstention, therefore it is tied. I will use my casting vote as I did before, and therefore the amendment is agreed. The question is that Section 62 be agreed. Not 62 sections in this bill, for those people who are paying attention. The question is that Section 2 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. I therefore call Amendment 15, I'm getting all the numbers muddled up. 15 in the name of Maurice Golden, grouped with Amendment 16. Maurice Golden to move Amendment 15 and speak to the both amendments in the group. Maurice.
Thank you, Convener. Happy to move Amendment 15. These amendments in this group are similar, but in some ways could be considered differently. Ultimately, the Scottish Government have accepted the principle of having targets, notably the net zero target for 2045. So my rationale is that interim targets would be helpful. I accept that carbon budgets are a more useful methodology than annual targets, but key interim targets on the road to net zero fit well alongside this. Amendment 15 is the 6-8% target not devised by me, not involved at all in the configuration of this target. This is in fact the Scottish Government's own target for 2030. So for Amendment 15, this is based on the Scottish Government's own assessment 5 years ago, and this should still be applicable now unless, firstly, the rationale in 2019 was flawed, or the progress from the same Scottish Government since 2019 has been poor, or both. So on Amendment 15, any member of the SNP must support it, or they are voting against themselves. It's very simple. I completely accept the 2040 target is a more interesting one, but I think the balance between, yes, having carbon budgets, but something we're all agreed on is having a target is very useful. Thank you, Convener.
Mr. Golden, just looking to see if any other members want to. Does Cabinet Secretary, over to you.
Yes, so Amendments 15 and 16, we won't be supporting, because they would set annual targets in 2030 and 2040, but the Committee for Climate Change has already made it clear that carbon budgets are preferable to that a system of single year targets, and that's the approach that all other governments across the UK take as well. So I can't support these amendments on the basis that first retaining single year targets alongside carbon budgets would do the opposite of providing the clarity that's needed at this important juncture. Yeah.
So I'm just really interested, obviously the 68% is what the previous Cabinet Secretary has been on record yes. as saying is easy to, but ambitious, but possible to achieve. So this is just the codification of what the Scottish Government policy is.
So I don't remember Rosanna Cunningham ever saying the word easy in relation to meeting targets, but 68% is the NDC target for the UK Government is set for 2030. And obviously we work with the UK Government when they set the NDC as to whether or not we agree with that. So effectively we still have an NDC for 68% if we're in line with the UK Government on that. And in terms of alignment, I mean, one of the reasons that we're moving to a carbon budgeting system is to have that same process that the other governments across the UK have as well, and of course taking the advice of the Committee for Climate Change that the carbon budgeting system is the best way forward as well. So I can just finish this point. So I think that having this single year targets would not give the clarity that's needed and the basis that would be setting our targets after we've received up-to-date CCC advice. We were setting out our carbon budget envelope. I'd urge members to reject these amendments. I'm happy to take an intervention, convener from Monica Lennon.
Thank you. I mean, it was just a question, and you've started to, in part, answer it already, Cabinet Secretary, but I'm just trying to better understand, because I'm sympathetic to what Maurice Golden is trying to achieve, but, you know, I'm trying to understand what are the practical difficulties of having the targets that Amendments 15 and 16 would bring in alongside trying to do the carbon budget. It just feels like we're going in different directions here. So I'm just trying to understand what would the practical difficulties be.
So I would agree with your assessment of that, because effectively we're setting out the five-year carbon budget for the reason we said it takes into account fluctuations across the five-year process. If we've got the single-year targets, that's completely taken away from that approach as well, and the nuances around that approach, which the CCC have given the advice on. But also remember that in the background we've got the NDCs, as agreed by the UK Government, and it's set for 2030 at 68% as well, which I believe the Scottish Government, and I'm looking at my officials, have, you know, agreed with in principle, you know. So that's a UK Government, NDCs are set by them, and there's still that sort of like notional 68% for the whole of the UK in terms of their emissions. So I just think it's clouding the kind of clarity that a five-year carbon budget gives in that process. It's effectively having two different systems at the same time. Yeah,
whether
yeah,
you want
yeah.
to take
I'm looking at you, if you'll let me, yeah.
I appreciate that, Cabinet Secretary. I wonder, though, if you would acknowledge, because I don't think you acknowledged earlier on when I moved Amendment 7, that many people looking at that 2030 target, 75% by 2030, is being hugely important in terms of signifying the early action we need to take in order to tackle climate change. How does that work with the budget? How easy is it for somebody to look at where Scotland is and say we're on track or off track towards meeting 2045? And isn't there a way that you can articulate the budget in terms of those important milestones which people campaigned for on the streets and which this Parliament delivered?
Yeah, well, that's just
about the changing date for when we might actually meet.
We've just had a grouping about the monitoring and evaluation reports that are required if we're slipping back. So I think that gives, and obviously think about our first carbon budget, if it's going to be set next year, would take us to 2030. So you would have a report on that, the end of that carbon budget by 2030. Convener, I'm happy to.
Okay, that's perfect. Maurice Golden, can I ask you to wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 15, Maurice?
I think this grouping actually provides the committee, indeed Parliament, with a significant challenge around monitoring and reporting with respect to this bill, because 5 years ago today, the Scottish Government SNP members, excluding Jackie Dunbar, voted for Amendment 15. Now, as we configure in carbon budgets, how on earth do we ensure that in 5 years' time we don't have a Scottish Government looking back and saying, well, actually, do we want to change the methodology again? What we said 5 years ago is now not applicable, and then we will not achieve net zero. And the closer we get to 2045, the more significant that challenge becomes. And essentially, Amendment 15 is a challenge to those members who were in Parliament last session to either stick to the principles in which they applied 5 years ago or ditch it. And if they ditch it, I think that's a challenge for Parliament in terms of how we ensure scrutiny going forward with respect to this bill. Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. And I'll confirm you're pressing the amendment. Yes. Yeah. So the question is, Amendment 15 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed, therefore it be a division. Those in favour, please raise their hands. Those against, please raise their hands. And those who wish to abstain, please raise their hands. There are two votes for, there are four votes against, and there will be one. There is one abstention, therefore the amendment is not agreed. Sorry, we hadn't got to not move.
Right.
Mr. Golden, just trying to help you to remember that conversations which are loud enough for me to hear distract me, and I certainly can't do more than one thing at once. So call Amendment 16 in the name of Maurice Golden, already debated with Amendment 15. Mr. Golden, move or not move?
Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 13 in the name of Mark Ruskell, already debated with Amendment 38. Mark Ruskell to move or not move?
Not moved.
I therefore call Amendment 62 in the name of Mark Ruskell, grouped with Amendments 64 and 49 and 50. Mark Ruskell, can I ask you to move Amendment 62 and speak to all the amendments in the group?
Mark. Yeah. Thanks, Convener. Very, very happy to speak to 62. I mean, there's a heavy reliance in the climate legislation on the advisory body, which is the UK Climate Change Committee, and I think, you know, we all recognise they provide really invaluable formal advice. They also provide really invaluable informal advice to governments and to this committee as well. But I think it's fair to say that over the years that have been in operation, over the years that this Parliament and the government have engaged with the CCC, there have been issues around their capacity, around their resources, and around, given that, how responsive they are in terms of being able to provide the advice that is needed at the right time, given changing circumstances. So if you think back to 2023, when the climate change plan was delayed, Chris Start was very vocal in that effectively that delay had thrown out their work programme, had thrown out the window which they had available to provide advice for the Scottish Parliament about our emissions reduction progress. So effectively we've been in a position now where there has not been that level of advice that this Parliament was expecting because of the capacity of the CCC and their work programme. And we were in a similar position in with the 2019 Act as well, in that the CCC was unable to provide formal advice on the 2030 target because they were still completing their work on the peatland inventory. So actually, when we did set that target in the 2019 Act for 2030, we actually didn't have full advice from the CCC at that point. Not their fault, but it was to do with their work programme, to do with their capacity. So I'm moving this amendment because there is a provision in the Continuity Act in relation to Environment Standards Scotland that whenever they produce their annual report, they have to give a statement in relation to whether they have adequate resources to discharge their responsibilities or not. And that needs to be communicated to Parliament. We can't require something similar from the UK CCC, although I think it would be very preferable if they could state publicly about any issues they have to do with capacity or resources. We can't do that in terms of the way the CCC is set up, but this amendment is competent in terms of requiring the Scottish Government to report on whether there are issues to do with capacity and to consult with the CCC
in so doing. I think, yes, absolutely, yeah.
I'm going to blame it on my fuzzy head. Here, I just want to understand, because when I first read the amendments, the point about resourcing, the way I read it, I thought that you were talking about the resourcing of the CCC. Am I right now that you mean Environmental Centre Scotland? Is that what you're talking about?
No, the point I'm making is that there is precedent within the law for another body, Environmental Standards Scotland, to have to report on an annual basis as part of its annual reporting on whether it has enough resources to discharge its responsibilities or not. What I'm saying is that it would be, to my mind, very useful if we had the same requirement or the same information to be presented in relation to the UK Climate Change Committee. At the moment, we do not know whether they have adequate resources to enable them to discharge their responsibilities. So I'm saying that a similar provision would be useful. I'll finish by saying, look, climate change is complex. I think the work the CCC are doing is great, but there's always new and emerging stuff for them to look at, blue carbon, for example. And it's important this is a body that can really keep track of the Scottish context. So there has been discussion in the past about whether there should be a separate CCC or whether CCC should have an office in Scotland, whether it should be focused on the particular challenges that we're all aware of. I think that does bring in a question about resourcing, and I think that should be an open discussion, because if they're limiting our ability to scrutinise on the basis of their capacity, then that's a problem. In terms of other amendments in this group, I'll listen to how 64, 49 and 50, the intention behind those.
Thank you very much, Mark. I think, Douglas, you're moving Amendment 64 in the name of Brian Whittle.
Yes.
And speak to that amendment and any other amendments in the group.
Yes, Convener, I'm speaking to 64. They're basically all the same. So the Climate Change Committee is named on the face of the UK legislation, but not the Scottish legislation. So this amendment specifically names the Climate Change Committee or any successor organisations as a relevant body that ministers must take advice from. I think we all agree in order to keep advice non-partisan, advice on climate change plans and budgets should come from an independent source, and this is just putting name in the Climate Change Committee on the face of the bill. Thanks, Convener.
Thank you very much. Cabinet Secretary, I think it's your turn now.
Thank you, Convener. So I appreciate the intention behind Amendment 62 lodged by Mark Ruskell on the broader point of ensuring that the Committee for Climate Change is resourced. It's raised in the Stage 1 report. And the CCC, of course, is a vital partner. Government's committed to ensuring it has the resources and information that it needs. But I must emphasise that the Committee for Climate Change is jointly funded by the four nations of the UK. There are funding arrangements and mechanisms in place that make that work. This amendment would make only the Scottish Government legally responsible for plugging any shortfall, however that arises, in relation to one aspect of the committee's functions. So making one partner legally responsible for funding a narrow aspect of a body's works is not how this arrangement works, or how it should work, I would say. I would urge the committee to reject Amendment 62 because the funding capacity of the Committee for Climate Change is a joint deliberation between all four governments across the UK. Amendments 64, 49 and 50 from Brian Whittle seek to prevent the Scottish Government and this Parliament from deciding that various functions under the 2009 Climate Change Act should be carried out by a body other than the UK Committee for Climate Change or the successor body set up by the UK Government. So the Scottish Government has no intention of having anyone other than the UK Committee for Climate Change carry out those functions. But Parliament did decide, when it passed the bill for the 2009 Act, to provide a mechanism for another body to be appointed, should it ever be deemed appropriate at some future point, including allowing for a specific Scottish Climate Change Committee to be set up. And it reaffirmed that decision in the bill in 2019. So there's been no discussion at Stage 1 about reversing those decisions of the Parliament, and I can't see any reason that the committee should be called into doing that today. It's not any question that's been posed to anyone in your evidence taking. Yes.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. It was just a question on Amendment 62 in Mark Ruskell's name. Your setting out your position has been helpful. But I am sympathetic to the points that Mark Ruskell raises about making sure that the UKCCC is adequately resourced and has the correct capacity, but also recognise the need for the four-nation approach. And I don't think it's Mark Ruskell's intention that the Scottish Government would do, you know, all the heavy lifting in terms of funding. But I just want to know, in terms of resourcing and capacity, has the Scottish Government had recent discussions with UK Government and others about that? And is there anything that you could say to reassure committee that would be something that would be looked at on an ongoing basis to make sure that, in terms of the busy work programme, there are sufficient resources?
So the IMG is the group that we have with all the four nations represented, and the capacity for the Committee for Climate Change and the funding arrangements around that and the advice that we need, all four of us moving forward to net zero. That's a discussion that we have regularly. Most recently had the IMG 2 weeks ago. This particular issue didn't come up. Obviously, we've got a new chief, a new CEO of the CCC as well, who I haven't met yet as well. If there's any capacity issues, that's the sort of thing that she'll bring to all four nations as we have those deliberations as well. But I do stress that this is a discussion that is had between all four governments, each one playing their part, each one committing to funding their appropriate part. I'm not saying that the Scottish Government doing all the heavy lifting. I think all four nations do the heavy lifting in terms of taking their equal responsibility for funding the CCC.
As you finish, thank you, Cabinet Secretary Mark Ruskell. Can I ask you to wind up and press a withdrawal amendment 62?
Yeah, thanks very much, Convener. I've listened carefully to what the Cabinet Secretary said. I mean, I don't think there's anything in Amendment 62 that requires the Scottish Government to fully fund the Climate Change Committee. The amendment is very much in relation to the work that that committee does in relation to Scottish carbon budgets. I think it is important, though, that this issue is continually raised, whether that's through interministerial forums, you know, so be it, because I think an understanding of what our needs are, what are the emerging issues that are coming out, deliberation of a climate change plan or the budget, and the capacity of the CCC to deliver on that needs to be an active conversation. So I won't move it at this point. I'll consider whether this is worth revisiting at all ahead of stage three, but I won't intend to move 62, but appreciate the Cabinet Secretary has, I think she's acknowledged that this is an issue. I'm not sure.
I think she has.
Yeah, right. Okay.
Sorry.
I didn't miss what did I just agree to there?
No, that's fine. That's fine. That's fine.
No. In bearer bonds. Well,
if Mark was asking me a question, I'm quite happy to answer.
Mark, could you... Sorry, because the Cabinet Secretary nodded, and that can't be put on the official record, could you ask her how much you were actually asking for, or what you were asking for, which she was agreeing to?
It's not for me to write the financial budget for the Climate Change Committee, but I think it was an acknowledgement about the issues and the issues around capacity.
Yes, and actually, I'm happy to write to indeed the committee about any conversations I have at the IMG or directly with the Committee for Climate Change on that.
Okay, so I think we're in the position that Mark Ruskell seeks to withdraw Amendment 62. Does any member object to the amendment being withdrawn? No one objects, and therefore the amendment is withdrawn. I therefore call Amendment 55 in the name of Sarah Boyer, group with amendments and shown in the groupings. I remind members that under Rule 9.12.6C, the presiding officer has determined that the costs associated with Amendment 19 in this group would in themselves be significant. Therefore, Amendment 19 may be moved and debated, but the question on it may not be put in the absence of a financial resolution. This is obviously where you were asking for your money from. But in the first instance, Sarah Boyett, can I ask you for Amendment 55 to move Amendment 55 and speak to the amendments in your group?
Thank you very much, Convener. The aim of my amendment in this group is a very simple one, which is to place a timescale of 2 months on the publication of a draft climate change plan and all future ones. And I wanted to include this amendment as a way of stopping this government or any future governments for kicking the plan into the long grass. And I've said from the start of this process that the priority should be an action, which doesn't feel we've had enough so far. And I think 2 months is a reasonable time frame for a draft of the plan to come before Parliament. And it does allow flexibility for when the UK Climate Change Committee will publish their guidance. I do want to say that due to the swift process and timescale in submitting these amendments, Amendment 55 will in turn need to be amended at stage three if colleagues will support it today, because it's really vital that the timescale applies only to the draft climate change plan. So in discussion with the Cabinet Secretary, I'm very grateful that she has assured me that she will submit the appropriate amendment at stage three, so we both get the intention of this amendment today and realise it in absolute practice. So we'd be very, we'll say in advance that Scottish Labour will support that amendment when the Cabinet Secretary brings it forward. I think my amendment is preferable to Maurice Golden's. His is just restricted to the first climate change plan, and I think it's important that we have a longer term approach rather than just the first one, and I hope the Scottish Government will honour their commitments to publish this next plan quickly. I think it's also preferable to the time frame from Mark Ruskell, which I do think would work for 2025, but I think we've got to have a long term plan for this and require all governments to implement this going forward. As to Mark Ruskell's requirement and suggestion for an interim plan, I do think a ministerial statement would be a preferable approach, which would be enabled under Amendment 53 in the name of Graeme Simpson. So I'm inclined to support that, but interested to hear what Mark Ruskell says. I think the other amendments by Mark Ruskell, which consider all the different forms of consultation that would go into the publication of the plan, were very supportive of public consultation, but I do note the comments from the convener about the financial implications of Amendment 19. So I think very much support the ambition of that deliberative democratic process and actually bringing people forward with the Parliament and actually tackling our climate ambitions. That has got to be important. I think some of the other amendments by Mark are a bit too prescriptive for the face of the bill, but I think they're important to have them discussed. I do want to very much support Monica Lennon's Amendment 55, which I think is important because it would give us greater parliamentary scrutiny of the climate change plan, again, addressing the core concerns about inadequate action and a lack of transparency on what we've had previously. So I appreciate the overall thrust of amendments in this group, and I've been very supportive of the Cabinet Secretary's willingness to engage not just myself but other colleagues in the committee, because getting this kind of discussion, given the tight schedule we've had, I think it's been important. I think we need to get on with this because tackling the climate emergency has been the result of delayed plans, leading to slower non-existent action. It's held us back as a country. It's going to impact on our constituents, our environment and our economy going forward. So this bill is the opportunity for all of us around the table to make sure that it doesn't happen again. Thank you, Convener.
Sarah, and I'm going to ask Mark Ruskell to speak to Amendment 19 and other amendments in the group. Mark.
Yeah, thanks, Convener. I'm actually just going to briefly mention 20 before coming on to 19. So, you know, thank the Cabinet Secretary for engagement over this amendment. And I think following on from the discussion we've just had around, you know, the capacity and the function of the CCC, I think it is important that Scottish Government, you know, is able to take advice from other bodies. It's something that I think we heard in evidence that's reflected in the Northern Irish legislation. So, you know, grateful for discussion with the Government on that. In terms of 19, yes, we're in a situation where I'm going to speak to this, but I can't press it to the vote because the view of the presiding officer is that this would effectively trigger the need for a financial resolution in relation to this bill, which I think is disappointing because, you know, clearly the government does have a budget for public engagement. It is committed, I hope, to consultation around climate change plans, and I hope it's continuing to reflect on the importance of participative democratic processes and the work of the Climate Citizens Assembly, which of course came on the back of the last Climate Act, and I think was very valuable in terms of bringing forward thinking around diet, around travel, around how we heat our homes. I'm sure that was valuable in terms of government considering how it develops policy on the back of that. But of course, you know, Citizens Assemblies are only one way of doing this. Our own committee has commissioned a citizens panel on public engagement aspects of the Climate Act. Again, that was very, very valuable. So I don't want to be prescriptive here. I think it is for government to reflect on the importance of asking the public and asking people who are outside of politics, but nevertheless will have a view around the big behaviour changes that we need to make as a society to tackle climate change. And I think that's important in order to drive forward a social licence for some of the huge changes that we're going to need to see in our society if we're going to get anywhere close to meeting our climate targets. So I suppose I'm sort of looking really to the Cabinet Secretary to sort of follow up on this conversation between now and stage three to see, you know, how can we bake in that important role for public engagement in this bill to make sure that future governments are going to be really, really committed to that kind of work. I'll then just briefly turn to 25 and 26 and kind of other options in the space. And as Sarah Poet's saying, you know, we've already talked about the statement that came through Graham Simpson's Amendment 53 that could come alongside a budget. I mean, I think what we're needing here is more certainty about how government intends to meet the climate budget, what is required across society in order to get those climate reductions. So essentially, I have put forward one amendment here, Amendment 26, which would seek to introduce an interim plan for this period that we have 6 months after the bill's introduced. I don't feel that's necessary right now, and I won't be seeking to kind of move that. But I would like to push Amendment 25 to the vote, because, you know, there is an interplay between setting a carbon budget and then setting the plan. And I think in an ideal world, what we would have coming forward at the same time as the budget is a clear climate plan. So government is really open, transparent and honest about the kind of changes that will be needed going forward in order to meet those targets. And I think we heard in evidence that, you know, this needs to go beyond the kind of broad pathways that the Climate Change Committee will bring forward. There needs to be a marrying up of the climate carbon budget and the action that's actually needed to tackle. And I think the more that we can get that certainty about what is going to have to be done to meet those climate budgets as we're scrutinising the climate budgets, I think that would be an important way forward. I'm not convinced that what we've approved through Graham Simpson's Amendment 53 really does it. To go back to our initial discussion, I think it's still quite woolly. I think we need more of that detail to be brought forward next spring when we're getting these carbon budgets coming forward, and we need to make a clear analysis then of what is actually needed in order to meet those budgets, and whether government is then preparing and planning and has got the finance in place in order to achieve that. So I will push 25. I think, you know, in an ideal world we should be moving forward a plan at the same time as moving forward a budget. I won't move 26. I'll hold on to 19, but I will move 20.
Thank you very much, Mark. Monica Lennon, I'm going to ask you to speak to Amendment 58 and any other amendments in the group. Monica.
Yep, thank you, Convener. Yeah, I'll move Amendment 58, although I just wanted to check. I think Sarah Boyack may have misspoke, because Sarah said she would be supporting my Amendment 55, but just checking I've got the numbers correct. So Sarah's is 55 and mine's is 58. So we've got that on the official report now. So, yeah, it's been a long morning, and I do agree with my colleague Sarah Boyack, the comments that she's made, so I wouldn't bother to repeat some of those points. So again, on 58, pleased to say that I've worked closely with the Scottish Government on this amendment. 58 will require that ministers respond to parliamentary scrutiny on the draft climate change plan within 3 months of any committee report or parliamentary resolution related to the draft plan.
I really apologise for the sniffles here. Colleagues will know that Section 35A of the 2009 Act makes provisions for parliamentary scrutiny of the draft climate change plan and ministers' response to that scrutiny. But there is currently no specific timeframe in the 2009 Act within which ministers must respond to that parliamentary scrutiny, other than the deadline by which the climate change plan must be finalised. Ministers' response to Parliament scrutiny could be included in the statement that accompanies the finalised climate change plan when laid in Parliament, or earlier if ministers are taking longer than 3 months to finalise the plan. So again, I'm pleased to have worked with the Government on this amendment, and I hope that colleagues are able to support it. I think it's been made clear that I am supporting Amendment 55 in Sarah Boyack's name. And just to say that, you know, having listened to Mark Ruskell in relation to his Amendment 25, it just strikes me that 55 is a better option, as it does give the Scottish Government or Scottish Minister a bit more space and headroom to produce the climate change plan. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Monica. I'm now going to call on Graeme Simpson to speak to Amendment 22 in the absence of Maurice Golden, who's had to go to another meeting. Graeme.
Yeah, thanks very much. Amendment 22 specifies a date for publication of the draft climate change plan. However, it would cut across Amendment 55 in the name of Sarah Boyack, and we prefer Amendment 55, so we'll not be moving Amendment 22.
Thank you very much, very succinct. Any other members wish to contribute? No. Cabinet Secretary, over to you.
Thank you, Convener. So, recognising that Amendment 19 can't be voted on today, the Scottish Government supports Amendments 20 and 58, but can't support 22, 25, 26. Very pleased to work with Sarah Boyack on Amendment 55, and she has my commitment to bring forward a little amendment in Stage 3, just to tighten that up, and I appreciate her cooperation with me on that, so that's great. Amendments 55, 22 would set different deadlines in relation to the first climate change plan. Obviously, we've had a bit of a debate here, and 55 is coming out as the preferred option here, and I'm very pleased about that. I will move on to Amendments 25 and 26. Continuing with amendments linked to whether a climate change plan can be produced, I can't support Amendments 25, 26 from Mark Ruskell, as they would require some kind of preliminary version of the draft climate change plan. I think my phrase, a draft of a draft, has been used quite often. And if they were only produced those tables, it would only sow confusion. Very conscious that while we are engaged in detail of work, wider Civic Scotland wouldn't want to see an endless stream of drafts of draft plans and interim plans. The options of that have been discussed with Sarah Boyack and Monica Lennon are far more preferable. And, of course, the information that I have said that I will produce in relation to Amendment 53 that Graeme Simpson moved earlier and was voted on, I think will help that process. I think I'll leave it there. Amendments 19 and 20. So Amendment 19 called for public consultation to inform a climate change plan, and the Government does that anyway, would be doing that anyway, and I've got absolutely no objection to it being formalised at all. I know we can't vote on that amendment today, but I would have supported it if the subsection 2 hadn't been in it, and I think that was a subsection 2 that would require the financial memorandum. But I just want to say to Mark Ruskell, we certainly could work with him on something ahead of Stage 3 there, and I have absolutely no difficulty with Amendment 20. It formalises a sort of wider engagement on climate change plans with particular groups that the Government is already meeting with and collaborating with in a regular course of business. So I'm very happy to support that amendment. There is a minor technical issue with the way that Amendment 20 refers to Section 9 of the 2009 Act, so I might come back to do a little bit of amending of that at Stage 3, but I can discuss that with Mr Ruskell as we go forward. So finally, briefly, I welcome Amendment 58 from Monica Lennon, which would set the timescale for the Government to respond to parliamentary views in a draft climate change plan, and I think I'll just leave it there.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Now, Sarah Boyack, I'm going to ask you to briefly wind up and press or withdraw Amendment 55. Come apparent in a minute.
Okay, thanks, Cabinet Secretary. First of all, I do want...
I would love to be the Cabinet Secretary, but I'm not. I'll just correct myself,
Convener. I do want to thank Monica Lennon for setting the record straight, re-amendments 55 and 58. I amended my own draft notes incorrectly. I think this is about trying to improve the legislation, and we've talked about that again and again. So very, very important for us that... there is discussion with colleagues after today's discussion in advance of next week's Stage 3 debate. So I think getting the Cabinet Secretary's commitment on the amendment by Mark Ruskell is really important, because we want to maximise consultation, certainty, improving the legislation so that we actually are able to talk to third sector organisations, businesses, environmental experts and our own constituents so that we actually don't fail future climate targets. But I do welcome the fact that Graeme Simpson gave support to my Amendment 55 and the work I've done with the Acting Cabinet Secretary to make sure that we get this going forward. So I'll stop at that point, Convener. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Sarah. So the question is that Amendment 55 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. The question is that Section 3 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Now, this seems to be an appropriate moment to pause for us to have something to eat before we go on to the next section, and certainly, Cabinet Secretary, for your officials to recover from the shock of finding out I was the Cabinet Secretary, albeit briefly. The look on their face says they need a moment to compose themselves. So we'll break briefly now until 1:30. To 1:20. We'll reconvene at 1:20. Thank you very much, everyone, and I suspend the meeting.